She works for the ELCA, which is the Evangelical Lutheran Church in America, and her job is to work with churches in West Africa, Madagascar,
Central Africa.
It is amazing that we even got her to be in New Jersey today. She just happens to be on the continent, and she came to New Jersey. So we are so happy to have you, and please welcome her.
Grace and peace to you from God, Creator, Redeemer, and Sustainer. Would you pray with me, please? Gracious God, pour out your living waters on us at this hour. May the words of my mouth and the meditation of all of our hearts be acceptable in your sight, because you, great God, are our rock and our redeemer. Amen. I want to thank you, Pastor Lee, for inviting me to be here with you this morning. It's good to be in New Jersey. I served in New Jersey for 9 years as pastor of St. John's and Summit, and now serve the ELCA through the Global Mission Unit as the Area Director for Madagascar, West and Central Africa. That's a mouthful. What that means is that I'm responsible for projects, programs, and personnel in 9 countries and on an island. Some of you heard that in adult form. But right now, I don't want to so much talk about what I do. I want to talk about the gospel text for this 14th Sunday of Pentecost. When I read this text a few months ago, I realized that I didn't like it or any of the texts for today. At the same time, I knew I had to read this awful text closely to tell you that I believe Jesus is pointing out our responsibility, showing us our power, and issuing us a promise. It begins. If another member of the church sins against you, go and point out that fault. Jesus, through the writer of Matthew, is talking about sin and conflict between church people. And you know what us nice Lutherans people want to do with conflict. Avoid it. But Jesus is telling us that we should confront sin, that we should go to the one who has sinned against us, and that we should speak. Why should we do this? Well, I believe Jesus is asking us to do this because sin disrupts relationships, hurts individuals, disturbs communities, and wreaks havoc in the world. Jesus says, if a member of the church sins against you, go point out the fault. Yet, don't get carried away. You have to consider what manner you're carrying out this pointing out. Do you take pleasure in pointing out someone else's fault? If so, be warned. Usually, I'm a little disappointed when I experience, as a person of color, a microaggression or a slight. Yet, I call a thing what it is. I'm also disappointed when a person points out that I overlook their feelings. As a matter of fact, that happened to me in Nigeria. Someone was telling me how uncomfortable they felt being put on the spot in a big gathering in a strange place, and I sort of told them, oh, no big deal, because I'm used to doing it. Instead of sympathizing with them, understanding that the situation was new for them, I brushed it off, and I brushed them off. I hurt their feelings. I sinned against them. Thanks be to God, that person could point out my sin. Though I was taken aback, I had to acknowledge my sin, ask for forgiveness, and try not to ever do it again. Of course, it could be any of us who sins. As Lutherans, 500 years from the Reformation, we acknowledge that we are both saint and sinner at the same time. Jesus says, if a member of the church sins against you, go point out the fault. If you do, and everything goes well, the text tells us your relationship is strengthened and remains intact. But if your sister does not listen to you, you are to take one or two others, not to gang up on your sister, but so that you have witnesses to what is happening. Witnesses to the gentleness and care you are taking as you point out this fault. And if that is not successful, Jesus tells us to take it to the entire body, the church, the community, the fellowship of Christ, and hopefully this is sufficient. There is repentance, forgiveness, and reconciliation. If not, let such a one be to you as a Gentile and a tax collector. Pointing out a fault is a hard thing to do, yet Jesus offers us a way. And it sounds to us that Jesus is talking about individuals, and yes, he is. Yet most of all, this has to do with community. And while we can suppose that Jesus is talking about local community and specifically about church community, I want to propose that what Jesus is telling us also applies to systems and global community. If a member of the church sins against you. Most of the work that I do now is in Africa with companion Lutheran churches. There I see the sin of neglect and the ravages of poverty when children have a diet that consists of pounded manioc that fills the stomach and has no nutritional value, while others eat well. I see the sin of apathy when 1,000 die because of torrential rains and mudslides that destroys homes and livelihood in the crowded city of Freetown in Sierra Leone, and there is not even a mention on the nightly news, as if we in the North don't care about those in the South. I see the neglect and sin of colonialism, where railroads were built in the 1800s in Senegal, and when independence came, those who colonized the country retreated with no training or mechanisms to repair or maintain tracks or trains so that they sit as ruined eyesores across the country. I see the rampant sin of patriarchy that holds women in damaging relationships as 13-year-old girl children are given in marriage to men 3 times their age. And I see the sin of marginalization when everything that is not heteronormative is condemned, especially in the African church. This is the sin that we confront as we work in global mission. The phrase that our executive director highlights is touching lives for the flourishing of human community. I believe that the one who comes so that we might have life and have it abundantly empowers us to do this. Jesus says, if a member of the church sins against you, go point out the fault. Sometimes sins are not between persons, but the conflict is between groups or in systems, not entities, but in not individuals, but entities, not far off, but near. Rich against poor, black against white, Republican against Democrat, American born against immigrant, president against people. I don't like this. Thinking of sin or conflict against people who consider themselves to be those who follow God. I don't like thinking that we need to confront someone or some group of someone's who read the same Bible that we read, and yet this is what Jesus is telling us to do in the text. Doesn't he know that all kinds of things can happen if we speak up against sin or call into question what others take for granted? You know, like when I say something like Black Lives Matter and those who don't look like me get upset because they think I left them out. Yet the sin is that in this country, black lives have been those that are expendable and not as valuable as others. So it needs to be proclaimed that Black Lives Matter. But this speaking out causes conflict. When I say that this country was built not only on the backs of African slaves, but also on the industry and hard labor of immigrants, people get upset because there's an entire group of immigrants, those on our southern borders, and those whose religious beliefs do not mirror our own, that are sinned against as we attempt to keep them out using stereotypes and discrimination. We know all those south of the border are not criminals, and all non-Christians are not terrorists. And doesn't everyone deserve to seek a better life and have the opportunity that this country has historically offered millions of immigrants, including your ancestors? And what about the children? All those dreamers who only know the United States of America. I believe Jesus is calling us out in this text, and I don't like it. He wants us to point out the sins of those who have sinned against us, and it starts with us, individually and corporately. We sin as we deny climate change and ignore topography, geography, and care for creation, as we abuse the land and the consequences. As you can see, we're reaping the whirlwind. Harvey, Irma, Jose, all over the planet, there are floods, hurricanes, mudslides, fires, drought. And yet we, with decent livelihoods and resources, we will fare just fine. But those who live regularly in a state of poverty and lack, well, who knows? And because we sin, we keep building bigger houses, manufacturing cars that use fuel that we don't know is harmful, using up all the energy we can, any way we can, and we keep all that we have to ourselves at the expense of others. Yes, Jesus uses this text to call us out. If a member of the church sins against you, and the members may be us, so what do? We listen to the words of Jesus telling us that as Christian communities, we have great power. We have the power to call on the community, the power to name a thing what it is, the power to be transformed by the words of Jesus. The Bible says, "Truly I tell you, whatever you bind on earth will be bound in heaven, and whatever you loose on earth will be loosed in heaven." We have the power to bind what is sin in our world. Poverty, racism, greed, injustice, hatred. We have the power to loose God's love, grace, mercy, joy, forgiveness, and generosity. And there is more. We have the power to agree, point out sin, and petition God for help. Jesus says, again, "Truly I tell you, if two of you agree on earth about anything you ask, it will be done for you by my Father in heaven." So what do? We confess corporately every Sunday that we have not allowed God's grace to set us free, or that we have sinned in thought, word, and deed by what we have done or by what we have left undone. So we are not surprised when a fellow member or a group of fellow members points out our fault. We welcome it, we reflect on it, we ask for forgiveness, repent, and we move forward trying to do better. Individually and corporately. Oh, okay. I know all this responsibility, all that we want to do, living as Christians, as good Lutherans, as people that love God and the world that God has created, can make us tired and weary. It can make us throw up our hands, pointing out faults and having our faults pointed out, this is enough to make us want to give up and do nothing, because we don't have to. We know as Lutherans we are saved by grace through faith apart from works of the law, right?
Right.
Yet, just watch the news. Just listen to all the rhetoric. See the weather reports, and we see why we cannot give up. There is so much pain, injustice, disaster, struggle, you name it, in our world. And though there is nothing we must do to earn God's love, I believe we are being called out to do the work of God in the world. Living waters. There's something else. There's something else. We're not just hanging here all alone. There is a promise attached to all this pointing out and speaking up. There is a promise in all our sinfulness and trying to do the right thing. There is a promise for the condition of our world. And Jesus saves it to the end. He says, "For where two or three are gathered in my name, I am there among them." So rest assured, living waters, I didn't come here today to leave you in a state of depression, but to bring you hope, to speak peace amid all the chaos we see around us, to point out the promise, the good news that comes through Jesus the Christ, the one who stretched his arms out on a cross for us, for you and for me. This one who says we are to be treated as Gentiles and tax collectors when we do not listen or repent of our sins. So the funny thing is, this Jesus is the same one who eats with Gentiles and tax collectors and has welcomed even them and even us. With all the legalistic instructions in this seemingly difficult and awful text, there comes a promise. Yes, responsibility to name sin when we can where we see it. Yes, power to bind what is awful and to loose what is good when we can. Yet most of all, church, this text that starts out soaked in law, just like our world, offers us good news. Whether we are able to do as the text instructs or not, whether we are the one doing the pointing out or the pointed at, we are promised the love, the grace, the mercy, the forgiveness, and the presence of Jesus the Christ in it all. The promise, for where two or three are gathered in my name, where two or three are gathered in my name, Jesus says. No matter the circumstance, no matter the conflict, no matter the sin, no matter the difficulty of it all, I am there among them. And living waters, for this, I just want to give thanks to God.